had a hymn where we stood up. Then we had a hymn where we could have marched around. What we needed was a hymn where we could get back in our seats and sit down. So if somebody can think of that one, then Steve will have $5 for you, if you can think of that hymn. So, all right. Well, I was assigned to... We could do that after we march, but we still got to have a way to come back in here. So, all right. Well, before I get started, let's pray together, because that's kind of what this is about tonight. Lord, we are so thankful for ancient hymns that help us just to move along in our faith. The fact that we need to stand up for you at times is something very important in our lives, and something sometimes is difficult to do. And Lord, metaphorically, we need to be marching as soldiers in this battlefield of life and the world that we live in today, and we pray for strength to do so. And Lord, I just pray that as we look into your word tonight, you would help us and motivate us to be the laborers that we need to be, and to also find ways to call out more laborers unto your harvest, because as this passage is going to say, it's white unto harvest. So bless our time together, and we thank you for all that you do for us. In Christ's name, amen. All right, well, we've missed our pastor today, but Caleb did a wonderful job of preaching this morning, and it worked out just fine. And I did forget to say something this morning during the announcements, and I hope I remember it next week. Our team that went to had the race up at Westport Camp yesterday, it was a really good time. Carol and I got to go up and help out as well, and six or eight other teams up there, something like that, that all competed together. And I want you to know, our team got honorable mention at the race yesterday. Yeah, because they came in last, you know. But anyway, the point spread really wasn't that far of winners and losers, so everybody had a good time, and it was fun. Yeah, yeah. There you go. That's a good scripture right there. Okay. All right, well, tonight we're praying for laborers because the harvest is plentiful. And we'll see more of that in a little bit here. I think we've all heard, and we kind of know and we kind of understand, the 80-20 rule that's in not only churches, but probably every organization that you're a part of. And that's the fact that 20% of the people do 80% of the work. And I've heard that my entire life, or sometimes it's 70-30, something like that. You hear about things like that. And as I've said this before, and a lot of what I was going to say here, I've said it before, but the church really should be countercultural. We shouldn't be the same as all the other organizations. There should be something different about the church. And we need to be getting away from this 80-20 thing that we find ourselves wrapped up in, not only this church, but other churches around. But what can Rikers Ridge do about that? Well, we're going to find out tonight that we can't, but God can. And I want to do something, and some folks are probably getting tired of hearing this story, but I'm going to talk about Jehoshaphat again tonight, all right? We did it for a workers' meeting that we had right out here. I also started it in a Sunday school class. I didn't get to finish it because of a situation where I didn't get to come back the next week, but we were having a great time discussing 2 Chronicles chapter 20, all right? Now, you don't really have to turn there, but you can if you want to. I just want to tell the story again. Pastor Kevin a few weeks ago said something about, you know, reading scripture, a book, and you read it over and over and over again. Well, this story has just kept coming into my head time after time after time. And maybe I tell it one more time again tonight, I'll have it out of my system, and I can move on from Jehoshaphat. But Jehoshaphat was the fourth king in the nation of Judah, which is the southern kingdom. Israel became a divided kingdom. There was a northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. Well, Jehoshaphat is he's the fourth king after Solomon in that divided kingdom. He's made some mistakes in his kingship, but he's considered a good king. There's a time or two where he depended on other help outside of God, went to pagan kings and asked for their help, and God didn't really want him to do that. So he's made some mistakes. But in this particular chapter, in chapter 20, Jehoshaphat learns that there are three armies coming. It's Ammon, Moab, and Meunites, which are from Mount Seir, Arab kind of people. All right, we won't get into all the background of who they are, even though we did that in Sunday school and it was really good. But these three armies are coming. They're all gathering together, and they're kind of figuring up. They're realizing that we've got this many, and they've got this many, and there's no way we can win this battle. We're going to be defeated. So Jehoshaphat, in his wisdom, first thing he does is goes to God in prayer and asks God about it. And he talks with the Lord about this problem that's coming. Then he has the people to come and to pray and to fast. And so they do that. The nation of Judah represented. They come and they pray. And they hear from a prophet who tells them that God's going to win this battle for you. You just be brave, be bold, go out and do what you're to do. And that's what they do. Jehoshaphat says, okay, let's get this going here. And they worship even before this victory ever happens. They praise God for the victory that is coming. And I think it's very interesting. You read through that chapter, you find out what they did. They kind of lined up, and they're marching out to battle. They put the choir out front. They're singing out in front as they're going toward this area where they know this particular pass, where they know these three huge armies are coming. So I'm thinking, that's kind of like putting the marching band out in front of the army or something. You guys go out and play your horns, and that'll kind of throw them off, You're probably not going to survive, but anyhow, you do that. So that's how it's done. They get the singers out front, and they're singing this song of praise to God. And sure enough, as they march out, these three armies are on their way, and it says that, it's kind of like this guy got mad at that guy, and he starts fighting, and then they started all fighting together, and pretty soon, all three of those armies had wiped each other out. And there's the entire field where they were coming through is just lined with bodies. And it says that the plunder was so great it took Judah 3 days to take all those swords and weaponry and everything out of there. So they didn't have to raise a sword, just as the prophet said. So it was amazing victory completely in God's hands. And just to point out a few facts about that, the three enemies are overwhelming. It's something, there's no way they can win this battle. Jehoshaphat, just to remind you again, sought help from God, and then the people prayed. And then this is the line that keeps coming to me, and since I heard it several weeks ago now. It said, Jehoshaphat said, "We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you." He was completely dependent on God. And we often find ourselves in that situation, not in what we're going to talk about just tonight, but there's a lot of times things come up in life and we don't know what to do, but we just have to give it to God and let him work in that. And he defeats the enemies. And that's what happened. God defeated those enemies. Well, we have, as I've thought about it, three enemies, we need three enemies too. Three overwhelming enemies that keep the church kind of in that 80-20 that we find ourselves in. All right? I'm going to write them on the board up here. The first one is apathy. Now, Barney Fife says that's apathy, but it's apathy. All right? Apathy. And I heard a young lady just about a week or so ago gave a wonderful speech about being other organizations in the apathy that seems to be not just in churches but in Christian schools and volunteer organizations of all kinds. There's a general apathy in the American public at large. Actually, there's some figures that show that, say, 10 years ago, we are several million people down in volunteerism in America than we were 10 years ago. And that's kind of disturbing to realize that what's going on with people. Well, there's a general apathy, and sometimes we fight that in the church. In other words, we just really don't care. You know, I'm so busy in my life that I've got so much going on, and I'm not sure I really care about whether we have enough help in a Sunday school class or an adult class or Wednesdays at the Ridge or any of these other things. I'm just apathetic about it. The second thing, this word's longer, apprehension. I hope I spell it right. Almost didn't have enough room. Apprehension. All right. And that's, I'm not sure if I can do that. You know, so I've kind of got some fear that I know there's a need there, and you've come and you've asked me, but I'm afraid I can't do that. And I'm afraid if I try it, I'll fail. So I'm kind of apprehensive about taking that step in helping out. And I've already mentioned about in being in apathy. I've got so much going on in my life already, I'm not sure I can take on anything new. So there's a general apprehension in the church, in the public at large, where we're dealing with these things. All right, the next one, this is a big word, apoplectic. They all had to be A words, you see. That's the Southern Baptist thing, you know. All right, that's not apoplectic, that's apoplectic. All right, that word is generally used with a medical kind of connotation, apoplectic, in that it's an apoplectic stroke, it's a paralysis. You do hear it, or I have in other discussions, it's a paralysis of some sort in all kinds of things, apoplectic. All right, so it means that we are paralyzed. And the first thing that we are paralyzed with is the fact that sometimes we have apathy and apprehension that totally paralyzes us. So we're in an apoplectic state, apoplexy, you might say. We don't, you know, and we just can't seem to get out of that. We grind and we do all we can, and we're trying so hard. We're not calling on the Lord, and we're in that kind of state. Again, we can be paralyzed because we got so many different directions that we go. We get our kids involved in everything, and we get involved in everything, and we want to go here and we want to go there, and we're going to be entertained all the time, and we want to be served rather than to serve, which is just the opposite of being what a Christian is, and all, so all these things, and we get in that kind of state, and it's a paralysis for us. Sometimes it's just a general lack of knowledge. We don't know that need is there. We don't know how to go about filling that need. We're not certain about God's word. We really haven't studied it enough. And so we just end up in a situation where we're just locked into it. Sometimes it's the paralysis occurs because we're just, the church is not central to our lives. Christ and the church are just kind of one of those things that's out there in our sphere, you know, and it's just something that we kind of do occasionally when we can grab a hold of it, but it's not central to my life. And I kind of grew up with the church was kind of all we had. And everything kind of revolved around that. And I thank my parents for that, that if it interfered with church, it wasn't, you know, you probably weren't going to do this thing because church was going on, you know. And I'm very thankful for my folks bringing me up that way. But I'm not so sure it's often that way these days, that it causes a paralysis. You know, I can never get involved. I can never do the things that I kind of feel like I need to, but I can't get there. And it's probably one of the reasons of this paralysis is that the church is just not central in our lives. Well, we have these overwhelming enemies. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Now, I hope you've enjoyed the introduction to this tonight. All right? Now it's time for us to go to God's word in the passage that we have tonight. Now, I've got it up on the board. It's in the ESV version. I'm kind of hoping you're going to open your Bible and look at it as well. Matthew 9. It's actually 35 to 38. I had it in the bulletin because I texted it wrong, but it's 35 to 38. In other words, the end of the chapter here in chapter 9. So we're going to look at this. I'm going to read it off the board, and you open your copy if you get a chance and read along, and then we're going to talk about it, okay? All right, God's word says, "And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, 'The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest.'" All right. So this is what we have before us here. God's word telling us how we need to face. This is probably just a few of the enemies that we actually have. I did three because the story had three. But I think that we kind of covered things. But I want you to talk to me now. Some of you said you couldn't see this back there. Maybe some of you can. I know I couldn't. If I was very much farther away from this, I couldn't see it even up here. But this first one, I made a little note here. This tells us what, all right? We need to start here. We can go down here and just kind of say, okay, we need to pray, all right? Because the message is pretty clear. This is nothing complicated. But let's don't forget about what, all right? What was Jesus doing first? Let's talk about that. What do you see there? Active? Okay. Yeah, one of those is proclaiming the gospel, right? What else do we see? Healing. All right, healing. Anything else? Teaching. All right, now, I noticed this in my ESV. It's not as easy to see. Somebody read me from the New American Standard, this verse, verse 35. Who's got a NASB? That's what us young people call it, the NASB. All right, anybody got a NASB? All right, I like the word going in there, all right? Here we got went, and he's winting, you know, and this didn't work out as well. So I'll underline the word went, but in other words, he's on the move. As Steve said a while ago, he's active, all right? So he's busy, and as he says other places, he's busy about his Father's kingdom. So he's going, and this is not necessarily, okay, everybody needs to, you know, you need to go to Africa, you need to go here, you need to go there. We need to be involved in those things as a body of believers. But we might need to go across the street. We might need to go and get involved in different ways. So the going is a good part of that. Obviously, we want to be listening to the teaching that's done from the pulpit. This is the main place. We want to be listening to the teaching that's in our Sunday school classes and being a part of those things. And also, if you have that ability to teach or to help teach, then we need to be involved in that, because that's the what. This is what we're doing. We're going, we're teaching, and it's very important for us to be proclaiming the gospel. Now, to keep trying to point this out to make sure we understand, we can look at a story of Jesus or an Old Testament story and say, now look at this good thing that they did, and you need to be good like this too. You know, dare to be a Daniel. That is good that we see those kinds of things in God's word. But if that's all we do is just teach children and young people and adults to go out and do good things, we've actually missed it. Because we need to attach the gospel to everything that we're doing. Because we know that, like, if we have the admonition to stop doing that, you know, stop talking about people, stop gossiping and this sort of thing. And we say, okay, we're all going to do that, you know. I'll do that for sure. Well, we go out the door and we get in our car and we go home and we say, did you see so-and-so's hair today? You know, or the lack of it or whatever. And already, you know, we're not doing the good thing. So that's why we need the gospel of Jesus Christ. is because we realize that we can't always do the good thing. So let's don't ever leave out what Jesus Christ has done for us. So a very important part of the what? Proclaiming the gospel. Let's don't forget that. So that's the what. And here's the why, all right? What is the why in verse 36? Why are we doing these things? Yeah, the word compassion. I don't know if you have different words, but Jesus had compassion for them. If we live in a community that I could say is relatively stable, it's not too bad. We do, although we are seeing a lot of things where we could kind of describe a good deal of the people in our community now as harassed and helpless. And they're harassed and helpless because of bad choices that they've made and bad choices that their parents made and their grandparents made. And they're kind of in a paralysis situation of just kind of repeating the same things over and over and over again. We're seeing a increased drug use in our community. We're seeing increased crime in our community. We're seeing increased suicide in our community. So there's lots of things going on that aren't good. And it's not a bad community, but we're seeing signs that it's a changing community, not just in Jefferson County, but sort of this whole region. Homelessness is up. There's all kinds of reasons for homelessness beyond that. And that compassion that we need for people. And it kind of takes me back. I didn't talk about healing here, but I should mention a few things about healing, all right? We're not necessarily called to go out and change the entire society by starting at the top with government and working our ways down. Nothing wrong with being involved in government, but our healing is twofold, all right? We should do what we can to help people in their situations where they have sickness, illness, and these sorts of things. But I think our major part of our healing that we're about as a group of people is spiritual healing. And that's what actually helps all the other things. And that healing comes about because of the knowledge of the gospel of Jesus Christ and receiving him as Lord and Savior. So we see that compassion. We see that we have a community that needs a lot of healing. And it should inspire us and compel us to move in that direction. Yes, sir.
Should we see that as action, as Christ taking away the disease or being with them and helping them through the sick problem?
Well, it's probably both, I would say. You know, we want to pray for people and for their healing, but we know through our experience that, people aren't always healed just because we pray. And so we want to come alongside them. Some people seem to be, it's part of their spiritual gift, that's just kind of their thing. They want to come alongside people and help them through these difficult things they're having. So I think that's part of the healing, is the church being involved in prayer. We have that prayer chain that comes out, and we receive those prayer requests from not only members in our church, but all kinds of folks that we're associated with. And I think we need to take the time. Probably as soon as you get that, you need to pray. If you're like me, you'll forget it. So I think that's part of the healing that we're doing. But also, as people are going through difficult times, do they know the Lord? And do we really care? Are we apathetic about it? And that kind of thing. So that's kind of how I see it. Yeah, it is always important. John's talking about going back to those verses prior to this and seeing what was going on there, and it helps us see, again, the what, why, and where, and how, and all that of what he said for us to do. So, all right. And then how are we going to do that? Well, how did Jehoshaphat do that when he was coming on things? Because this is stuff that, I mean, you can get up and give motivational speeches, you know, and it might help for a little while. But we need something deeper than that. We need a transformation in our hearts to overcome apathy and apprehension and apoplexy, you know. There's something inward needs to happen with all of us and the folks that we know. What is it that Jesus said to do? It's we pray. And we're praying first for the laborers to go out into the harvest. It's not a problem that we're going to be fighting over who to minister to. That's not a problem. They're all over the place. And there's all kinds of situations and everything. It's all there. The real problem is that we're not going out. And I know that the deacons are talking about changes and the way we do things and all that. And there's a process kind of going on behind the scenes to kind of help out with these situations. But we realize that our first act needs to be in prayer. And he mentions one of my relatives here, Ernest Lee. Earnestly praying, okay? You know, need a little drum there, we need to be earnestly praying. And I think that means that it's kind of over and over again. You know, let's make this, you know, a part of what we're praying for laborers unto the harvest. And I know that there's a lot of you sitting here, and you serve on Wednesdays at the Ridge, and you serve with Truth Finders, and you teach in Sunday school, and you come to all events, and I'm thankful that you do. But you have to admit that sometimes you get worn out, don't you? And it would be helpful if we had other folks come along and get involved. And, you know, I've had folks talking to me about, well, there's some other things that we need to do, and need to create this so that we can go out here and go out here. But what happens if we create new ministries if we're still in these situations? It just makes it worse. Now, I'm all for doing more, but if we take the same people and just kind of double up that labor, then we wear people out. Yeah, was that you, Natalie? We just really can't do it, can we? We can't do that. You can only stretch so far. We're not Jesus, you know? I'm not Jesus. I'm nowhere close. I don't have enough hair for it to begin with. I couldn't play the part. I can't do it. So prayer is what we need. That's where we begin. So this group right here, I wish there were more. I thought, you know, I kind of thought what I said this morning about that big shot preacher going to be here, and I thought maybe draw out more, but they figured it out, I guess, okay? They figured it out. But we need to pray. And what I want to do right now is just to start that way. I just want you to sit right where you're at. You don't have to stand up for Jesus or march around or anything like that today, all right? Although I want you to do that at times. But I just want you to stay right where you're at. And I'm just going to call out some things. I want you to silently pray. Just right now, just pray for these things as the things that we've talked about that Jesus has told us to do here. So no fancy music, nothing like that. Just bow your head right where you're at, and you lift up silent prayer, and I'll have a little prayer, and then I'll call out something else to pray for. Lord, we want to come before you tonight because that's all we can do. We want to be like Jehoshaphat and realize there are things that we really have no control over whatsoever, and all we can do is call out to you. And Lord, the first thing I want us to pray about is the fact that we need to be going. And Lord, we want our teaching here at Rikers Ridge to be sound. So we want to lift up those that we think of, like our pastors, Sunday school teachers, those that lead on Wednesday nights, truth finders, and leadership of various kinds right now. Lord, help us in proclaiming the gospel to be creative and reaching out and finding ways to be involved. Lord, as we think about the word healing, we realize that there are many that we pray for that have physical difficulties of many kinds, but help us also, Lord, to think of those who have spiritual needs and pray for them as well. And Lord, may we be like Christ when we look out in our community and see the difficulties that are there. And again, they seem like overwhelming enemies. And Lord, help us to repent of any lack of compassion that we have had and to have a greater love because of your example and your sacrifice on the cross. Lord, you are the Almighty. You are the Lord of that harvest that is out there. We are only mere tools in that situation, but we pray that you would call us out. Maybe even within this room, there are those who have not yet done what you've asked them to do. So help us to think on this as we pray briefly. And also, Lord, help us to think of maybe one or two individuals that might need to step up here at Rikers Ridge and fulfill the ministry that you've called them to do. Now, Lord, we thank you for this quiet moment of prayer. And we lift up these things to you because you, as Jehoshaphat found out, you're the only one. We have to lean and depend on you. In Christ's name, amen. All right, any closing comments anybody wants to make before we move on? All right. Well, let me do this. I've been enjoying these scriptural benedictions that we've been having on Sunday mornings. I really like them. And one of those is, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. And all God's people said.
Amen.
All right. You are dismissed.